Now, who hasn't hunted whitetails next to a big old apple tree with apples dropping and deer coming in? Some of my earliest bow hunting memories are back in 1985, 86, 87 in a giant apple tree, a couple hundred yards off the field edge. I quickly learned, you know, and this is how we learn, by mistakes, but I learned when to hunt that apple tree and when not to. And I learned that if I went in there in the morning hours, a lot of times deer were already there and I risked spooking them. And then guess what? In 1987, in the evening, after I spooked them in the morning because I couldn't wait to sit by the apple tree stand, it was a board and a big giant old white pine, and I was looking down an apple tree. Then I quickly realized that my hunt was ruined in the evening too. The deer just didn't come back because I spooked them in the morning. It was a long time ago. Learned these lessons the hard way. And all those dreams of hunting those giant bucks in the evening that came in the apple tree were dashed. All those. And back then we were happy to shoot a 2-3 year old buck, especially a 2 year old. And just that was one that really stuck out. So to me, over the years, I've learned a really big strategy as it relates to habitat and improvement on private land. But whether it's public or private land, I've learned three strategies of the best times to shoot a buck, shoot a deer at an apple tree. And I'm going to explain those three strategies and why and how it relates to your hunting, and I hope they make a lot of sense. The first one, one of my favorite, is that apple tree that's well back in cover, and it's adjacent to open hardwoods, non-bedding area, but then it has really good bedding area behind it. And while I don't believe the moon has anything to do with the rut overall activity, I do believe it peaks activity levels within a 24-hour period as whitetails feed. For example, if there's a rising full moon in the evening, deer hit the fields, hit the food sources late. They'll be feeding high in the hog. It's safe and social all night long, and they're tired when daybreak hits. So they're back by those bedding areas. So like that 1986-87 stand location in lower Michigan in the Flat Thumb area, then when I was back into those locations at daybreak, I risk spooking deer because they're already feeding on the apples and they're right next to their bedding areas. Where if I would have waited to that stand when I went in the evening, the afternoon, 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon, great spot because deer were just transitioning between long distance food and cover. But especially full moon rising, deer feeding all night, they're already in their bedding areas, then I could access a stand like that hour after daylight, 2 hours after daylight, really looking for that late morning pickup. If you think about it, deer feed 5 times in a 24-hour period. I say that all the time. But if 1 or 2 feeding cycles out of those 5 and 24-hour period are high, then the next ones are going to be low. No different than if you or I went to our favorite restaurant, pizza parlor, made our favorite dish or grilled something at home. We gorge out. We eat a lot of food. You can bet we're probably not eating that much food. Thanksgiving dinners. I've had some massive Thanksgiving dinners where I shoved as much food as I could, especially that stuffing. I love mashed potatoes and turkey gravy. And then didn't really eat much later that night after we watched my Detroit Lions potentially lose and all those Thanksgiving Day games. You just eat less, feed more. It creates a roller coaster, and that's what the moon does. And so to me, that's that late morning time. Deer in their beds at daybreak. It's that late morning time where they get up, they start feeding heavy. And if it's next to their bedding area and you have that lone apple tree or a group of apple trees out in the woods, and they're near that brush and cover, maybe some early successional growth, what an outstanding spot to slip into an hour or two after daybreak, wait till that late morning time, early afternoon, and really have a great chance at a buck next to his bedding area. And that's especially enhanced when you have that moon and that moon phase where it's rising in the evening and it forces deer out of their beds late morning to replenish after really resting at daybreak during that feeding cycle. And then if you think about it, if they're feeding heavy then, that's why a few hours later at daybreak or at darkness, they're not coming into the food sources very much at that time because they fed heavy the middle of the day. They're going to feed heavy at night, and that's that roller coaster, I believe, that the moon actually cycles through. Now there's those other apple tree locations. That one's back in the woods near bedding. Then you have those apple tree locations that might be next to a clear cut on public land, and it might be off to the side, off to the corner of the woods. We have one right over on the side over here, and there might be a great opportunity to feed on an apple tree, you would think, in the morning as deer are transitioning through there. But again, you're spooking them if you wait till a post-daybreak stand entrance. It's well away from bedding areas. That seems to be that lone apple tree that they're hitting They're hitting it on the way to their evening food source, and that's a great opportunity for you to slip into the evening. It's a well away from bedding, but it offers pinpoint precision accuracy on the way to that evening food source, and a great opportunity to shoot a buck. You might have a mock scrape nearby, you might have a water hole nearby, but it's that little dot in the middle of movement between bedding that might be 100 yards away or more, maybe even 300 yards, and this watch deer, just that window of movement at the apple tree for a quick stop and break before they travel 100 to 200 yards or more to a distant food source. Outstanding evening. If you kind of think about it, that could be that middle of that bow tie, where they might be spreading out to major food sources in all directions past the apple tree, and they might be coming from lots of bedding areas in between. On the other side, you're just hunting that apple tree in between, and it creates a bow tie of movement. You can get in and out of it easy because you're going through open area, open hardwoods, open food sources to get to that apple tree, and you're just hunting that afternoon food source movement. And finally, those big open clear cuts, big open ag fields, where you have that lone apple tree off to the side or corner, that you can actually put a stand location near that corner, especially if it's the shady side of the food plot in the afternoon, evening, where deer are coming into that shade feeding, so they're not out in the bright sunlight baking like we are right now, but they're off to the corner of that food plot. You can get in and out of a stand location. It's right on that food source, food plot, clear cut, whatever it might be, and those deer entering the food source in the evening about an hour before dark. This is well after they transition by that other evening food source apple tree that's off to the side 100 to 200 yards. This is right at the food source. And those are the three ways, you know, whether it's that apple tree in the corner of a big food source on public or private land, that apple tree that is 100, 200 yards away from that food source and 100, 200 yards away from bedding areas, so you could get in safely in the afternoon, evening and hunt. That's a risky spot to hunt in the morning. They might be right there when you enter. And they're not gonna be cruising maybe all the way out to that outside edge during the rut, during the middle of the day. It's just got evening movement. And then of course that morning lone apple tree or clump of apple trees back by a bedding area, they can slip in maybe an hour or 2 hours after first light and wait for those deer to come back to you and have that precision movement. There's sometimes you can slip into that before daylight, but that's the type of spot you want to get into early. Make sure your downwind is covered, and it might offer that precision pinpoint movement where deer are coming back to their bedding areas. And finally, really good apple strategy that I've learned throughout the years, especially in the habitat management years, is that my favorite place to plant apple trees or to have apple trees are on food sources, on food plots, because this just reinforces the movement to the food plot that we're adding out here. It adds another dimension, a higher level of quality, and it keeps deer. There's a lot of places where you have apple trees back by bedding areas you can't get into without spooking those deer. So imagine that buck stepping up half hour, 45 minutes before darkness. He goes to that apple tree that you can't hunt because it's back by his bedding area. He feeds on it till dark, and he doesn't move across your land until after dark, because he fed high in the hog until dark on those apples, and he just didn't need to move during daylight very far. So I'd rather have those apple trees at the food sources next to a giant clear cut on public land where he's coming from a little further away, a distant point where you can offer that precision movement. You can keep them here during the daylight. One more reason for them to come out here, and that's why I don't like planting apple trees back in bedding areas where it can hold a buck potentially until dark and not get them to move by a stand location. And on top of that, that's why I like planting hard mass, oak trees, chestnuts, whatever it might be, back in their bedding areas. It's a woody mass. It's hard to digest, and it's completely different than the greens we offer out in these food sources, whether it's late planted beans, late planted peas, oats, wheat, rye, and any brassica combination of tillage radish, radish, turnips, and rape in these evening, afternoon green food plots. I like keeping soft mass apple trees with these big food plots if I'm going to manage that on private land, and then keeping hard mass back in the woods so you create that separation of quality of feed, creating the movement. And those are three ways that you can hunt apple trees that I look for. And I would say my favorite, if you guys know me and my love for finding that next great morning stand, the fact that I shoot a high percentage of my bucks in the morning, I love to have those apple trees you find back in next to a bedding area with good access into that stand location if you're not spooking deer in the morning around food sources or at the apple tree when you go in. I love those type of setups. I hope that you can hunt some apple trees this year. Boy, there's a lot of memories to last a lifetime that have been created hunting over apple trees, including my own, over 30 years ago. And those first mornings of, or first opportunities for hunting apple trees, I hope you can create those memories this year. Apple trees are awesome when it comes to bow hunting and whitetails. And they may just be the perfect natural food source. And we're very fortunate to have most of our food plots out here already lined with apple trees. They're already planted. I probably don't need to plant anymore. We have this giant one behind me. We have one right over here. And then spread out pretty well on this property. And we're very excited about that. And we can't wait to hopefully bring you some good apple tree footage of a buck coming in and sucking down some of that nice fruit in the afternoon. And hey, maybe we'll even put an arrow through them on film. I hope you have a great fall and get a chance on a big old ancient apple tree on the land you hunt this season. Well, if you made it to the end of this video, you're obviously interested in Whitetail Habitat Solutions, what I have to teach, and you will love my new web class series. The first one is How to Design Your Whitetail Property. It's out now. The link is in the description. I invite you to check it out. It's on my website. Can't wait to hear about it.